Hey everyone, welcome to Global Voices. My name is David Parks. I'm the director of the Global Center. For those of you who are from another part of campus, welcome. Good to have you here. Today it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Tom Steffen. He is here kind of on loan through Southeastern Bible College. He's here doing a conference with them. And speaking of which, we have the privilege of having with us the president of Southeastern Bible College, Dr. Alex Granados. Say hello. All right. Thank you for being here. Dr. Steffen, he spoke for us several years ago. It was my first year here at Beeson. I had him here to speak about his book, The Fourth Era of Missions. Is that the name? Okay, The Fourth Era of Missions. He is a leading missiologist. I studied him when I was doing my PhD program. He's written on church planting, orality, storying, and he's also written a book called Great Commission Companies, co-authored with Steve Rundle, and that's what he's going to be sharing today. The conference they're doing this week is on faith and I'm calling it faith and work. That's from the perspective of seminaries. It's actually something different. I'm going to ask you a question about that later. But talking about business as mission, and so I wanted to take advantage of this opportunity to have him share about that with us. We get to see the perspective of a missiologist in terms of business's mission. So if you would, please welcome Dr. Tom Steffen.
I have this one, so probably. I think I'm on. Yeah, I hear. Good. Well, good. Good to be here. But I really feel bad that I can't eat while you're eating. Oh, good. Okay, well, today we'll take a little time and look at what is a Great Commission Company. This is one of the major things that is happening in missions today for multiple reasons. So I'll just begin very simply with what is the question, what is it? And then we'll take a look at it, and then I'll try to define it first, and then I'll give you two case studies, two of my favorite case studies, actually, out of the book. And we'll take a look at that, and then we'll look at how can pastors help in this type of looking at Great Commission companies. How can they be instrumental in helping expand the kingdom of God through their teaching on what is the biblical perspective of work and what is the biblical perspective of business? Tying this all together so that the workplace actually becomes, and the business place actually becomes, the place where ministry takes place every day, all day long. And this is the place where these people who are involved in this are actually worshiping God through their activities on a day-by-day basis through that. So that Christianity, what? Addresses everything that these people are actually doing. And that's what makes Christianity then relevant to them. When they show up on Sunday, they get charged to be doing their ministry on Monday through Friday, or whatever their hours are and whatever their days are. So let's begin by taking a little look here at Great Commission's companies. And I want to divide it up a little bit and distinguish differences, because a Great Commission company has its own field. Doesn't mean it's better or more superior or any of that kind of stuff. It's different. And that's what we want to make sure that we understand, how these businesses are actually different. Secular business, I mean, my son-in-law had eight businesses in the area of tile, and set those all up for himself. He's just a high school graduate, came out, started getting into sales. Why should I make all these people money? I can do this. So he started his first business and put all his money, I mean, everything into it, okay? Second business, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, it grew. He was a multimillionaire before he was probably 25 because of that. But you couldn't tell if you're familiar with LA area, down in Anaheim area, down by the stadium, they have Mile Tile, okay? So there's a whole row of tile stores. You wouldn't know his tile store is different from anybody else's tile store on that Mile Tile. When it's just different. It was a totally secular business. Christian activists, we put them in there. This is where like Chick-fil-A comes in, right? They want to be driven by Christian values. So that's what they do. So we have In-N-Out Burger down in California. It does the same thing. Find a little verse reference on the bottom of the cup if you look inside on the bottom. That type of thing. But it's driven by Christian values. And so I'm not mocking any of these things. I'm just saying these are different than what we're going to talk about and move it up the thing and move it into now. Maybe we'll move it. There we go. There we go. Move it up into the Great Commission side of it. And in that, I've divided two ways in which you can do this. When either side, when no matter which side you are, they have a full-blown business plan, but they also have a Great Commission plan, and they wed those two together. So that's the idea behind it. And they can do it in two different ways. They can do it in a facilitative way, and I'm going to give you two case studies that will give one on each of these so you can kind of see the difference on this. But they'll give it where I can help make it happen, and I'll use the Pura Vida Company out of Seattle, which is a coffee company, that use their means of gaining funds to support workers down in Costa Rica, which we're doing the church planning and orphanages and that type of stuff. Or you can do it like Bill Jobe did it in a pioneer setting where you go in and you go actually on site, and this has happened to be in China, and start the business and you start planning churches through that business in ways that are, you can get away with it and do it and not get kicked out of the country. So there's all kinds of things that happen to make that happen. But so those two, a pioneer and a facilitative way of taking what we'll call Great Commission companies then that wed together a business plan and a Great Commission plan. It's not one or the other. It's wedded together. So here's what we how we defined this then. Out of the book, Great Commission Companies. And it came out in 2003, and it came out in 2011. So this is the updated version here. And we had a number of case studies in the 2003 one, so we wanted to see what happened to them in a period of, what, almost 8 years, a little over 8 years. And what happened to them, so we give you an update. So I'll give you you're going to get both the versions here this morning. This morning for me. I'm from Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. So I haven't just had breakfast. So we're working out really well here. We'll give you both versions of it, an updated version of it, what happened. And it's interesting what happened. Great Commission Company then is a socially responsible, income producing business managed by kingdom professionals. And we use that term, there are a lot of thought went into that term and why we use that term. Now I'm going to unpack each part of this for us as we go, but I want you to see the highlight of that term of kingdom professionals, created for the specific purpose of glorifying God and promoting the growth and multiplication of local churches. And we specifically wanted it to happen in this place. Doesn't mean it always has to, but we wanted to put the spotlight in this part of the world, in the least developed and least evangelized parts of the world. So that's our definition. So let's take it and we'll walk it through socially responsible here. And what do we mean by that? So broke it down a little bit. And how does God rule in these relationships that an employer has to the employee and the employee has to the employer, and then all people that they deal with, the creditors, the suppliers, the customers, just the local people in the area and so forth. So those relationships, how are those worked out? And that, where do they come out at? So you can, I just put a scale here, they can measure that and see what it said. Because God needs to rule in each one of these relationships. This is where the witness starts to be seen. This is the opportunity that business people have with a lot of other people that the professional clergy will never have opportunity to do. This is where their ministry can really, really thrive. One other aspect of it is the whole rest issue. And because we find in Genesis, God not only created and worked really hard, and he was really thankful for what he made. He thought it was really, really good what he came up with. But he also what? Rested. And this is one of the things. Does the boss burn out? Does he burn out his employees? Does he burn out the materials that he uses out of the environment? As I grew up as a kid, small kid, probably as 11 or 12, I was driving tractors and trucks all over the place. Because for a farmer, he had 7 fields. Every year, one of those fields was rested for the entire year. So how do we rest our environment so that it goes on for multiple generations? We don't just rape it all right now and we take it and it's ours for our generation. What we can get out. No, we're thinking long, long term here. We're thinking generations. So we have to think of that but part of it too. How does God's rule then relate in the area of rest? Here's a big one that, see if we can get her going here. When it comes to Great Commission companies, is that it actually makes a profit, okay? And one of the things we see as we look in the Scripture is that God is the one who actually gives the ability, the gift set, the skill sets to be able to actually make a profit. There's nothing wrong. There's actually something called righteous riches. Can happen. But there's a lot of things out there that will tell you, and even the Proverbs will tell you, if you're rich, guess what? Somehow you got it unjust, or you married into somebody or work with somebody that is unjust, okay? There's that view of profit out there that is very, very negative. But if we look at Scripture, there's also the other side of there is such a thing as righteous riches. How did Job get his riches? See? And you read through that and you'll see that it was God behind that. And even after the whole thing that he had to go through, what does he do? He doubles his riches. His family increases. His stock increases. Not his stock, but his animal stock, okay? That type of thing. So in the free market system, that there's actually a moral foundation behind it. Because what does it do? It offers goods and services considered necessary by somebody, and they are willing to give you in return something back for that. And I'm talking about stuff that is, okay, you know, we're not talking anything here, but we're talking stuff that will actually bring glory to God. So it offers good, you offer goods and services. Somebody's willing to do that and to repay you for your work there in that. It provides people opportunity to earn success by creating some. Here, we're giving the gifts and skills that God has given us. Now, we're all different, and that's by design. And we're able to create something. That things that we create is useful to somebody else and will help and benefit their lives as well. And in return, they give us something back. And that helps our lives to go on as well. So when we think of profit, we need to think of it from that perspective. Here's one of the verses that we need to remember. It's written for Israel, but the implications are it's broader than that as well. But remember, the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth. That's where it comes from. There is such a thing as righteous riches. For some reason in the Protestant church, we have a negative opinion of being able to make money like that and so forth. Okay, I just want to introduce a little book here written by a friend of mine, actually teaches at Talbot there, the School of Theology. He's calling it The Family Business. It's all in the family business. Kind of cute little title. But he talks about commerce in that book. And he says, God created commerce. And actually, commerce creates community. Here's where you get your relationships built, right? Remember all the different things we had lined out there? This gives you opportunity to express the kingdom of God to people who, you know, are never going to hear of Christianity, never going to hear of Christ, except probably through your means of being able to do it. Commerce creates economic viability. Commerce serves the poor. Commerce provides a natural, this is great, a natural way for the gospel to spread. When we worked in the Ifugao in the Philippines, and it's central Luzon for you, so your main island, if you above Manila, and there was no roads. We used aircraft to get in and out initially. Now there is a road in there. But who pays for you to be here? Because I wasn't working a job. You don't have any rice terraces or, you know, pieces of land in the jungle that have coffee or anything else. It didn't compute with them. I didn't do anything, you know. You can tell them who does it. It's just like, whew, didn't make any sense. How do you make money, you know? Who pays for you? Anyway, commerce is good because it's a wonderful place to share your spiritual story and help people fall in love with Jesus Christ. Great little summary of his book there. Okay. It's managed then by kingdom professionals. We chose this term purposely because this is around where at the turn of the century, 2000 we're talking about here, and in that era and a little above it. And what was happening, what we saw happening out there in the tent maker world was that people were going out and they'd have a business office, they'd have a card, file cabinets, phone, it looked like a business office. During the day, they weren't in there. They weren't doing any business. They were out on the street with people doing real ministry, traditional missions in that sense. And what we saw is that was making a really bad name for tent making. And we didn't want any part of it. Remember, they do have to make a profit. If they're not making a profit, if they're only out there and they see ministry as only doing evangelism, only doing discipleship, leadership development, and church planting, they've missed out what the real definition of ministry actually is. That work is actually worship. Our means of being able to do worship. And then there's always a time for that articulation of that and where and when that happens. It could happen on the work station. It could not work. You know, it has to be afterwards, depending on your job and what you're doing. So we wanted to say, no, it is managed by kingdom professionals. Okay. This would never apply to any student here. Has no reference to any student at this place. J.I. Packer, you gotta love this guy. He writes, the blunderings of sanctified amateurism, impervious to the need to get qualified in the area one hopes to function, are neither good Christianity nor good business. In other words, what? We need to be professionals in what we do, no matter what it is. Be professionals. Those are the gifts and skill sets that God has given you. You use them to the best of your ability. Good old J.I. Packer. So we got to get away from this. Anybody can do missions. Anybody can do business. No. There are some competencies that are necessary for successful businesses that are managed by then kingdom professionals. You got to have some business skill sets. You've got to have some, if we're doing this in cross-cultural settings, then you have to have some intercultural studies to help you understand what in the world's going on and what you're doing. Otherwise, you're going to come from your own value sets, specifically for us in the West, for many of us, the guilt innocence, your guilt or innocence, your black or white. And you're going to run into honor shame societies and orientations and value systems that they're not going to wonder what in the world is he talking about? Why does he do that? I won't have time to go into all those kind of things. But these are patron-client relationships. How do you solve conflict in a cross-cultural setting, say? Like there won't be conflict in a business? Yeah. But you're going to have to solve it. But how do you solve it? And our natural instinct will be to solve it how we solved it where we came from. But you're in a different place now. So you have to have some missiological astuteness. You have to know what to do, how to do some church planning as well. And there's definitely overlap between business and entrepreneurs. You'll find entrepreneurial people in church multiplication and you find them in the business world. It's definitely overlap, but there's some things that'll have to be known as well. And the spiritual gifting side will come out. We want then a business, a Great Commission company business, that is also going to glorify God. This is the ultimate goal here. This is what we're really after. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. That is where we want to see things happen. The Matthew 6. Can't ever underestimate that. What is there? It's interesting, when we were coming up with this definition, Steve Grundle was with the School of Business, I'm with the School of Intercultural, Cook School of Intercultural Studies, and so he didn't want that. He said, well, everybody just does that anyway. And no, I pushed it really hard. I want it in there because I want us to go back and keep looking. Is this really in there? Are we really doing this? Not just assuming we're doing this, but we have to have some accountability to look back and see if this is the bottom line, one of the bottom lines of a good business. Okay, so one of the other areas then that we want to see happen is not just doing the business. And here's where the two plans wed together, where you have the business plan that should profit eventually, depending on how long it takes you to get profitable. Usually doesn't happen in the first day, first month, or maybe the first year, maybe the first couple of years, right? But eventually, we want to see this thing profitable. But we also want to see some ministries take off through this thing. Daily Christianity is being evidenced to all the workers there and to those associated with the business, being in the inside of the business and the outside of the business. That's all going to be seen, but we want to see that expanded so that churches are also coming into existence out of this whole thing. That it actually goes beyond. We want to see it happen within the business, and we want to see that extend through the family connections outside the business. And some places you can do that and be very visible in doing that. Other places, you're not going to be that visible, or you won't be there that long. So we have to be very careful and know our context. And how this can be, it can be done. It's just how it will be done will differ depending on how open the governments are to Christianity and so forth. So we want to see some house churches start. We want to see not just planning of churches, but churches that actually mature as well. We're not just out into getting planning another church. No, we want to plant churches that have become mature, that are capable of reproducing that same model. More churches that are more mature as well in their Christianity. So one of the other things then, the last part is here, where do we focus? And we want to focus on, as we put it in here then, on the least reached and the least developed peoples in the world. We wanted to say, I mean, because we come from such wealthy place. I mean, look, Birmingham, I only get down here once in a while, but what I've discovered, there's a lot of money in this town. There's a lot of money in the Christian world I'm talking about, okay? And we want to use those finances in the best way we can to expand God's kingdom. So we want to use it so that we can take in these poor people, that raise them up in sustainable ways. So not only do they become Christians, we address their soul issue, we also address their everyday life issue. Because what? The kingdom of God doesn't want to just get into one part of us. The kingdom of God wants to address the whole person, and not just the whole person, the whole family, the whole community, the whole state, the whole nation. Why do we do that? This is a great verse here. He defended the cause of the poor and the needy, and so all went well. Watch the question. Is that not what it means to know me? Wow. There's a searing question for you. And that's one of the reasons we included this, to make sure what God has blessed us with will reach this level of society and help move them up the ladder. Okay, so if we put it all together, here's some of the key results that we would expect to see. If we can do this, if we can get a great commission company actually in place. And so we're dealing with both the spiritual and the social side of it. So that's your holistic endeavor. That's one of the reasons we like BAM, Business's Mission, because it addresses the whole person, the whole community, the whole nation. So on the spiritual side, we would look for growth in the numbers of new believers. I'll give you that out of the pioneer model that we'll see Bill Jobe's model there in China. We also would expect to see growth in the maturity of the local believers. So not just numerical growth, but also maturation growth. We also want to see healthy harvesting, self-sustaining churches with active earning laity, that they actually have a means of making money, which that money then they learn to give back in, and now we get the thing really rolling here when that happens. We get generational growth going. There'll be revenue and earning growth for the business. There'll be job creation. Somebody's got to do this work. You offer them opportunity to be a part of this company, whatever it happens to be, whatever their role happens to be. But they get a job. Now they have income. That income can help better their lives, both on the spiritual side and on the social side. And there should be capital gains. So those are some of the results that we would expect to see out there. So let me move it now into give you two case studies, one from Seattle, Washington, and then the other from China. The one is going to deal on a pioneer setting, the Silk Road one. We call it, that's not what it's really called, but we call it that in the book to protect the people, etc. Pura Vida, that is its name. It will serve as a facilitative model in how to do that. In other words, it was established to increase funds, to give those funds to people who are doing the frontline work. The Silk Road is, we're out on the frontline doing that work through business and reaching both the social and the spiritual side of things. So what we've done in business's mission is we've moved beyond this here, being a good Christian company driven by Christian values. We move beyond that now, and we do it through intentionality. This is what it's designed to do. It's been thought through. The business plan's been thought through. The Great Commission plan has been thought through. And now we have an accountability group somehow. We have that in place so that during our board meetings that will take place, are you really doing what you say you're doing? How are you doing it? How well is it working? You have accountability. So you really get, you have to keep on track. So we need that. We need that. And so then it will move us up into the Great Commission of facilitative and pioneer. So let me move you first to the facilitative. And the Pura Vida company in Seattle. So we went up there, and the first thing we had to do, Steve Rundle is a coffee connoisseur, okay? Can't miss a coffee, you can't pass one. All right, and so we went to none other than Starbucks, all right? That was just when Starbucks was just getting going, it was moving, okay? And one of the owners actually was in that shop, so we talked with him for quite a while. And then we went just not that many miles away over to Pura Vida. And John and Chris, both of those guys are Harvard MBA guys, okay? They went to Harvard, did all their classes together, they dormed together, and once they graduated, they said, every year we're going to work together, meet together somewhere to keep track of what we're doing. So John goes into Microsoft, made millions, okay? Chris goes down to Costa Rica and starts doing church planting and does the orphanage thing as well. And so every year they would get together. So one year John goes down there to Costa Rica and Chris comes and they meet together at a coffee shop, and Chris gives him a gift, hands it to him. It was a packet of coffee. And John didn't say anything, just kind of like sat there looking at that coffee bag. So now Chris is thinking, don't you like my gift? is something wrong here? He says, you know what? We ought to start a coffee business. That was the beginning of Pura Vida. All good businesses start on a napkin, right? So the napkin was pulled out. They started inking stuff in. Said, let's start this. Let's get this going. Pura Vida was formed. And he started it because he had plenty of money at that point. 100% of the business profits actually went to into ministry. 100%. And of course, as the company grew, they couldn't do that anymore. So things changed. And I don't know what the percentage is today, but that's a little bit of the background there. So the Costa Rica side of it then, it was formed in 98. The annual this is the 03 numbers there, 1.8 million. They're really different today. And the profit support ministry in the Costa Rica thing. So that was the deal. So back in Seattle then, and the day we were there, they were actually testing the coffee, okay? So, and I don't see how they do it. I taste coffee and talk coffee tastes like coffee. I cannot. These guys, I mean, they're just the little distinct. Okay, that bag will go there, this bag will go there, this bag will go. You know, it's just how they do that. I don't know. So they take a spoon like this, and there's water. There's in this cup, this is water. There's water in this. And they taste it. Well, first they put water in their mouth, spit it out. Then they take that coffee, put it in their mouth, and they taste it, and then they spit it out. Okay, and they wash the cup, the spoon off, and do the same thing. They go around like that. So I kid you not. By the time they were done with this, they were all high on caffeine. Okay, they were really actually high on caffeine. But this is the office. You can see actually you can't. There's a basketball thing. They have to have basketball here for the breaks, right, during the work time. So, but this is what they were doing there and separating the coffee out. And then on the Costa Rica side. This is where they were doing the church planting and the orphanages and so forth. So when we came back from that, Dr. Cook was the president of Biola University then. So I went up to him and I said, hey, you know what? Why don't we get Pura Vida coffee in our school? You know, because all that money that we're giving to Bon Appetit, who we had a contract with, for their coffee, who knows where that's gone. But we know a percentage of this money is going to go back into the ministry. Well, so is the school. Why don't we do that? But we had contracts, so we couldn't do it. So we put it into one of our little restaurant, what I don't know what we call that thing, but
Common grounds.
We have little things students go into and you buy all the, like this thing out here, not the cafeteria, but the other one. And there's Pura Vida coffee in there. What's interesting, when you fast forward this to the revision in 2011, and we went back and looked at it, what happened? Their business, the numbers had gone up in the bit. Profit? Oh, yes, it was there. Not a problem. They were fortunate. They rode the Starbucks wave. They came in on this thing just right at that right time, and it just took off and followed the Starbucks wave. So that was there for them. But you know what they changed, which really broke then the our definition, at least, of the Great Commission companies? They said, we're no longer going to support things like the church planting that goes down there in Costa Rica. We're going totally social. That's it. Lost that one. So that shows you how it can change. The accountability group, he would say, is the one that said, we're not, their board said, we're not going to do this other part anymore. So they divided it up into the secular and the social. They went back to the Western model that we're all too familiar with and not seeing it holistically anymore. Pura Vida, 8 years. What a difference. Okay. Let me take you to China. And this was interesting because when we were flying around China, Steve Rundle decided he was going to get a kidney stone, which is not good, okay? You do not want kidney stones, okay? And it got worse, okay? So he said, this is not going to work. I got to get out of here. So he left me in China while he went to Hong Kong to the hospital. And so I'm flying around China. I don't know the language. I don't know, you know, I don't know these people. I don't know any of this stuff. So anyway, I ended up, one of the places that I went was to, this is Bill Jobe. How many of you have met him? Some of you have met him, I think. There we go. So and we just called it the Silk Road. And two factories in Farsan. These are all made up, okay. But over 300 employees back in that day, and the 3.1 million there. At that point, there was 8 churches planted, and a lot of social ministries that was going on. The backstory of this is really interesting. He was in the military, so he got a view of what Asia was like during this time. He always thought, I want to go back here and do some ministry in Asia. Came back here to Tennessee and got into discipleship and really got into it big time. And people just all of a sudden start flocking to him. And so now he's got like 1,000 plus people who are following him. So why don't we start a church? You could be the pastor. So I said, oh, okay. So he tried it. About a month in, he realized, I'm not a pastor. This is not for me. I can do the other stuff, but pastoring, and then he decided, okay, my wife and I want to go back to China, back to China and start a business over there. So that's what they did. And a guy from I think it was Michigan, who had some funding, like $10,000 or what, $12,000, and said, okay, I can get you to help make or set you up to make flies for fly fishing, right, with the different materials. And we'll get into doing that, but you have to learn import export to be able to do that. So they're over there learning the language, and he's learning import-export. He does that. He gets his little business set up. The guy dies. That was the end of the funding. And then the gal who was doing the books was really doing the books, okay? And he finds out money has been evaporating here. So he's learning this all on the curve, right? He's learning this. And so he moves into... you seen these? Tiffany lamps? Yeah. He moves into making glass and using Tiffany lamps to do that. you can see it's a very airy place. The windows open there. It's a beautiful place, beautiful working environment for the employees there. And light was very good all the way. So there's about 320 people, I think, were working there when I was there, making the different things like that. different types of glasses and so forth. And I was following him around. It was kind of like this, only all flat and spread out a little more. So I was following him around from one thing to the other. And pretty soon somebody comes up and says, we're making a butterfly here and we can't get the solder to stay in this thing. So they're talking about sometimes in English, sometimes in Mandarin. And so I was in and out on what was going on. And then pretty soon I said, well, let's just pray about it. Okay. This is ministry on the job, right? You think anybody didn't hear him praying around there, the workers? No. So what is that? When you can't do something, you ask God to help you to do it. See, that was the message that was being taught to them right there. And eventually they got it actually to be able to work. They went back and tried it, came back and said, yeah, it worked. We got it. Okay. I was also walking around, and I got behind. I was just watching all this little glass. It's fascinating to see how they do this. And pretty soon I hear from the back, glass hitting cement. I mean, you couldn't miss it, okay? So, I mean, everybody in that workplace knew something had happened here. So I make my way back there, and I'm watching Bill. It was like right there on that corner. And Bill and this other guy are having a little discussion. The other guy's not really talking. It wasn't a discussion because Bill was doing all the talking. And you could see from what he was saying, you didn't have to know Mandarin at this point, that this guy's getting it, okay? And so afterwards I find out what's going on. Okay, the guy had been warned before of making, not doing good work. So he told him in Mandarin. Everybody's hearing this, okay? And those who couldn't hear it, you knew the message was moving up. Everybody would know it within seconds, all right? China used to be made known for its silk. It made the best silk in the world. We make the best lamps in China. We make the best lamps in the world. And we will not have any inferior work like you producing here. Okay, talk about public shame. Yeah, it's a face culture, right? He did it. He was fined. He was able to keep his job. But you know the next time was going to happen. He won't have a job. But you know who else learned the lessons that day? Yeah. Everybody up and down that place. We're here to produce the best Tiffany lamps that ever existed. No shortcuts in this place. That's why we're here. Wow. Okay. Yeah. He also made glass for doors like that. And he actually came up with a machine that would cut glass, cut the hole out, and then cut the glass to fit in the hole. And you never knew there was any, you could not see anything that looked like one piece of glass, just two colors. Amazing. Amazing. The personnel that showed up, the gal, Chinese gal, just showed up one day and said, I need a job. I'm an accountant. He gave it to her, trusted her. And she's done a great job. His HR guy, I want you to go to every house of every worker in this place. Now, I don't want you talking to just some here, just here. No, you go to their house so you find out what's happening in their family. If they have needs, we have a fund to help do that. That's why he was walking around one day and somebody said, he heard them talking, two ladies talking while they were doing their work. He's the best boss in Asia. Oh. So you, what do you mean? I'm the best boy. What are you talking about? Don't you remember? When my son was sick, had to go to the hospital, you gave us funds for that? No other boss in Asia would do that. What a way. He's won the mayor's award at least several times. I could go on and on with the story, so that's enough. But that gives you, just shows you how that ministry is done in context of work. So Christianity becomes a total way of life. Here's some of the values that drove his business. So I asked him, what are the values that drive his company? Morals trump money. Reward performance, not equality. Employ the unemployable. And in China, you know what that means? You don't do that in China, okay? Those are the people you get rid of. They're the lowest of the low. He did it. Character is best when developed in the job context. Yeah. The eternal trumps the temporary. Relationships trump profit. Long-term focus takes priority over short-term gains. And so then I, you know, you hear a lot of things while I'm taking notes on all this stuff as I'm going through. So here's a quotable quote I took from Bill Job that I think is better. God gives us the business to see if we will continually give it back to Him. Wow, that's powerful. That is powerful. He gives us that business so that we can make money and we can be profitable, we can help people, and we can raise their standard of living. But He's always wondering, you going to give it back to me? Wow, pretty powerful. In Novak's book, The Blessing as a Calling, he says, business is, bear none, the best real hope of the poor. And this is one of the noblest callings inherent in business activities, to raise up the poor. Again, J.F. Packard, we need to see and say that business life is as much a calling from God for some Christians as missionary service or pastoral ministry is for others. How have some churches, notice that how, some, okay, I want you to get that, how they responded. Watch this quote. This is, I am now a sales manager for a major steel company. In almost 30 years of my professional career, my church has never once suggested there be any time of accounting of my on-the-job ministry to others. My church has never once offered to improve those skills, which could have made me a better lay minister, nor has it ever asked if I needed any kind of support in what I was doing. There's never been an inquiry into the types of ethical decisions I must face or whether I seek to communicate my faith to my coworkers. I never have been in a congregation where there was any type of public affirmation of my ministry in my career. In short, I must conclude that my church really doesn't have the least interest in whether or how I minister in my daily work. Wow, that is a sad, sad commentary. Or this one. For people in the pews, business can be both a calling and a ministry. My friend Neil Johnson says, but for people in the pulpit, business is often a mystery, and for some, even anathema. This question was asked in Christianity Today, I think it was 2005, and when business's mission was really starting to hit, go public and get the interest of people. He was asking the clergy, do we not owe the business people in our midst solid teaching about their calling? That it is actually a valid calling. They can have that. Well, what are some of the things the pastors can do then? And Art Lindsay just came out with it. Right before I came, I ran across this. And so I said, I'm just going to use this, okay? And then I left one blank, and I'll come back to that one. Watch your language. Okay, he's not mean swearing, okay? Watch your language in the sense of making professionals in the clergy different from professionals in the social, in business world. The hierarchy that we've claimed, see, there's the missionaries, there's the pastors, there's the business people. Watch your terminology that you use. Pray for people in the professions. Where? In the public services we're talking about here. So that they see that they're cared for. People understand what they're doing. They have needs, and they'll pray for them. But how are you going to do that? You got to interview your workers. You got to know what they're doing on a day by day. What are their issues? Like the HR guy did, he went to their homes. When is the last time a clergy visited, if you're not in the clergy, visit you in your workplace? I was privileged to have that happen to me when I was a kid, 16 years old, working in a foundry. And the pastor, who was bivocational, who ran the factory, came out into the yard to see me and to ask me how things were going. I've never forgotten that. Never. Oh, sorry. Come on. Stress that you can actually have a ministry at your work. Places where I'm never going to get into as a pastor, as a professional, I'm never going to get in. You're right there on a day-by-day basis. You have opportunities I will never, never have. This is the question to fill in the gap in the other one. How many different types of commissioning services does your church have? I was commissioned as a missionary to go out. I've never seen a business person commissioned to start his business. I've never seen a teacher commissioned as she starts her career in teaching in the elementary side or the high school side or the college side, whatever, university, whatever. We need to make sure we cover that to show that we understand what is important, where you're spending your time most of your life, and what you're doing. Okay, we'll end here. Then the great commission companies not only make a dollar, they make a difference. That's the idea behind it. So a few websites there for you.